business. You order one sandwich. Bodega Bites. How much is that?
Bodega.
Bodega Bites.
Bodega Bites. You gotta do it again. Yeah, he's pissed me to do the fucking intro. Welcome to our channel. This is Bodega Bites. This is the third podcast. Sorry it's been a while. We've been definitely MIA, but we're back at it. Today's, I say, biggest overall topic that we want to talk about is kind of just, what are we like that? We're talking about social.
Let's talk about what's going on in the world, man. That's it. You know, what's going on in the country, you know.
The power, too, of social media and finding social justice within the hip-hop community and how it affects the hip-hop community is definitely, you know, kind of like the oversight of what I feel like we're going to try to talk about in this podcast here. You can find us on Bodega Bites Podcast. We're on the DOS One Collective YouTube channel, which you're here. Make sure to like us, subscribe to us right here, somewhere. We'll put the buttons maybe up there. Who knows? Yo, this is Mr. DOS One. Welcome to the channel. Got my man.
War Ready D, your boy Derek here checking in.
What's up, baby? Yo, give me that pound. What are we doing? We doing the pound? Bow! Or the digital handshake shit. I don't know which side you're going to be on. Bap! You know? So that's it. Yeah, so we good. Welcome back. Yeah, we're going to talk. Let's dive straight into it. We're going to talk basically about what's been going on, police brutality, stuff in social media right here. So definitely wanted to go into, like, mental health.
Just talk about it.
And almost kind of what streams off of social media and is directly affecting the hip hop community. But first, I guess I would just address, like, I'm going to ask you, because I know how I feel, but how do you feel? Like, do you feel like the majority of people, let's say, that aren't in the culture or aren't around people that you know, do you think the majority of people think negatively about hip hop or rap music?
Damn, hip hoppers over there.
Majority of people? I honestly can't say. I don't know. I would say it's 50-50. I would say nowadays, you know, it's the most popular genre in the world, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't think that it's fair to say that everyone thinks that it's negative, because there's definitely not negative things of, like, I play, like, there's a Baby Shark remix that I play for my son all the time. Right? Like, there's absolutely no way that that could be negative.
Right.
But I do think there are certain things that are taken out of context that people kind of see as being negative. And historically, sure, yeah, it's been seen as negative of, like, the, you know, NWA days and things like that. You know what I'm saying? But I think we've gotten past that. I think what the biggest negative part is the image of the black man. I think that is a negative part, because hip hop is deeper than rap, right? It's a whole community of dancers, musicians, artists, you know what I'm saying? Just creators in general. And the thing is with hip hop, it accepts everybody. It doesn't matter if you were a criminal, if you're white, black, Asian, whatever the case may be, Mexican, we welcome everybody, right? So I think that the world has kind of, everybody realized that, because it's the most popular genre in the world. But I think the biggest negative part is the image of the black man, which a lot of people see as threatening. And maybe historically glorifying violence, you know?
Right.
So I would that would probably have to be my answer. You
know? Okay. Yeah, no, that's definitely fair. I mean, I feel like I'm right up the same lane. I feel like there's a huge difference. I feel like hip hop, you know, started in the 70s, obviously, in the Bronx, and then it is this culture. It was MCs, DJs, breakdancers, this whole community, artists, like everybody who came together and kind of just wanted to share their social injustices or the differences that they felt growing up, where they felt indifferent from, whether it be the state, the government, the system, how they felt, how they lived, their lifestyle. And I feel like it got misinterpreted along the way. And I think, yeah, especially like early on the West Coast, you got NWA, as violent and as honest and forthcoming as they were, they kind of just really were acting as a voice for the where they grew up in that community and what was going on in their life and what they were living, their reality.
Right. 100%.
But at the same time, it's like, yo, if you're going to make that into music and freedom of speech all the way, I believe I can fly, and freedom of expression, then that's really gonna, it could be taken two different ways, because not all of America is like that. So you're gonna have a bunch of people who obviously see it, they hear the curse words, they hear this and that, but it's almost, it's like rock music, you know what I mean? It's like it's a statement against just a way of living. It's like this angst, this feeling that you have that you want to share, like where you felt like it was socially unjust to do that. And then I feel like you were saying, like there's a difference between that culture and almost the new rap, you know what I mean? Like the whole connotation of what a black man is, or what the whole, you know, people looking at rap as, oh, it's all about money, it's about cars, it's about killing people, it's about guns, it's about violence. I think it's hard to say, because there's definitely more than a handful of artists who still do that.
100%.
And definitely a social media, I feel like when that ties in too, it's like you do have people who do have some of these mental issues, almost anxiety nowadays with rappers, who kind of feel like the new story, instead of talking about social injustices and social things in their music, which I feel like a lot of like KRS-One, like all these guys who are just super political with their flows, I feel like it's changed direction, but it's done it in a way where, yeah, it's popularized now. But then you have people like we're talking about, like Juice WRLD, like, you know, Mac Miller, like even Logic had the song, you know, the 1-800 number for the suicide hotline. Like, these are like the new norms of truth, I guess, because it's been so popularized. And it's almost a sadder version, and almost still like most of the stuff you hear now is either drugs, violence, cars. It's still the same shit, but I feel like it's moved on to a level where it is more concerning now for the youth. Not only are rappers a lot younger now, but I also feel like they're more knowledgeable and feeling, whether it be PTSD, anxiety, like things like this that you can just get because of the culture and the generation that we live in, where there's so much information out there, where it's so easy for somebody to feel like, oh shit, like who am I? Like I need to be like this. I see this on Instagram. And it's hard to say because I'm older, but I feel like for younger people, like they grew up with that in their face. Mm. So it's like, who are they? Who are they going to amount to? And who are they themselves? Especially growing up in New York, as we know, dude, there's just mad people everywhere.
Right.
Even in COVID and quarantine, there's mad people in the fucking streets. Like, it's crazy. Like, it's just regular summer. So being in that saturated environment, COVID or not, you know, growing up as a youngster, like, of course you're going to have this influence of the social media. And albeit, you know, hip hop is so popular, you know, rap music is popular. It is the new pop music that it's almost... It's hard. I feel like it's a lot harder for people to distinguish themselves between what is true and what isn't true in some terms. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think it's crazy because I was reading that Charlamagne the God had put out a book about anxiety. And I think it's good that we brought this topic up. For those of you watching who aren't aware, May is Mental Health Awareness Month. So it's perfect that we were thinking about that. We're talking about it because it's very important, especially during these times. I mean, you gotta, if you're under, man, there's help out there, and there's a lot of ways to do it. I know Shakti Das? What's her name? I forget her name, but she started Shanti Das from Def Jam.
Gotcha.
She started this thing called Silence the Shame. It's really about just being there for people, especially in the hip-hop game, who are just kind of like feeling down about themselves, feeling suicidal. Like a lot of people that she worked with when it came to like Usher, when she started on the Face Records, and then she moved to Def Jam, I guess in the early 2000s, and started working with a bunch of artists and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But along the way, a lot of the artists kind of ended up either committing suicide, not artists, but or even people that were, you know, A&Rs or just friends of the people in the studio or the execs that were behind all the music, you know, behind Def Jam. You know, just having these problems and these situations, and even in early hip hop, like you could hear, well, to go back, Charlamagne the God's book, Shook Ones, it's called Anxiety Playing Tricks on Me. Playing Tricks on Me, I think, was the song.
Good voice.
Yeah, the Fat Boys. So there's that, and then there's, bro, like, it just goes back so early to, like, and it's all over hip-hop, too. I mean, even nowadays, from back in the day, you're going to hear about people who have these issues, and they're dealing with it on a regular basis. You could hear it in their music. And, you know, depression is a real thing. I mean, even more recently, the Logic one, like we just said.
It feel like my life ain't mine. I don't want to be alive. I don't want to be alive. I just want to die today. I just want to die.
Or even, bro, I've had Juice WRLD on repeat for some reason for, like, the song Righteous for, like, the past week. I've been listening to it, like, nonstop, just because I'm like,
because the thing with Juice, man, is you can hear his pain. Like, for one, he's super talented, and the thing was that he would just have a stream of consciousness. That's why he was so prolific, because he could just go for days and days and days and just not run out of bars. And
right,
he was speaking his truth, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Unfortunately, like, when you listen to his music, it's just basically like a script for how his life is set up for the peak and the downfall. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All white Gucci suit, I'm feeling righteous. Yeah. I know that the truth is hard to digest. Yeah. 5 or 6 pills in my right hand. Yeah. Cody runneth over on my nightstand. Taking medicine to fix all of the damage. My anxiety the size of a planet.
And one thing that the problem is that Juice WRLD's lifestyle that he was living is glorified. But what isn't glorified is talking about your feelings. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Expressing how you feel. Because basically, like, if you put yourself out there, first of all, it's hard to do as a man in general, just in, like, men culture, just to put yourself in a position of being vulnerable, right? Like,
right,
if you do that, you're automatically deemed as being soft or a pussy or whatever the case
may be. Exactly. If not more so, because if you're doing that in the hip-hop game.
Right. So I think it's for a lot of people who do put themselves out there like that and kind of allow themselves to be seen in not necessarily the most masculine light or the light that the PR rep would think would be the best for them. You know, you're living your truth. And then what that does is that encourages other people to kind of come out and, you know, express how they're feeling, because everybody deals with heavy shit. You know what I'm saying? And
right,
one way to deal with heavy shit is to take Papa Zan, you know, do some lean, you know, smoke backwards back to back. You know what I'm saying? And that deals with the problem, but only temporarily. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I think that, you know, having these discussions and just understanding what good mental health is and what it takes to have that, I think that'll, you know, be healthy for a lot of people. Even people like Future, man, like Future, Juicy J, like, when Juice died, everybody was like, yo, like, I'm sorry for, like, all the toxic stuff I said, you know what I mean? Juicy J came out, he was like, look, if I encourage anybody to do drugs, I am sorry. You know what I'm saying? So
right,
people are starting to realize that, like, once you lose your life, like, once you die, there's no coming back from that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So they're realizing that the power that the music has and the influence that people have, because somebody may not be dealing with these same issues that their favorite artist is, but they want to be like them. So they
right,
so they emulate it. You know what I'm saying? So that's another problem that's happening, because people think that, you know, an artist is doing something because they think it's cool, but really they're dealing with demons inside that, you know, are kind of just percolating and, you know, festering inside, and then they just do it because they think it's cool, you know?
Right, because they look up to that artist. They're definitely like, yeah. And especially nowadays, it's more popular, and I feel like, yeah, for the newer guys, like we're talking about, it's so easy to hear a lot about depression and the way they, you know, talk about their perspective on life and whatever it may be. And it's hard, yeah, because you feel like a lot of the kids these days, they might feel that same pain. They might not voice the pain and have the courage to do it as much, but they probably are still like, oh shit, like, yo, like Juice WRLD, like, yo, these newer guys these days, like, they can do pills, they could do, you know, they could pop out and do whatever drugs they want to do, you know what I mean? And it's okay,
right,
you know? And then they listen to that song, they're like, oh, I'm fine, you know, and that's a very hard place to put yourself into as well. And it was interesting too. I'm not going to dive into it too much, but I was talking to April about it. Mm-hmm. And
let's talk about it, man. What's up?
This I definitely want to make sure I quote. Like in Korea, social media is a huge thing. We've got K-pop, we've got entertainment industry, we've got acting, we've got actresses, we've got people in radio, people everywhere. But just, I'd say it, entertainment industry as a whole, we were talking about. And I asked her, it's kind of when you get, I wouldn't say like shame, like you think of Doja Cat and you think of, oh, okay, some people are like, eh, whatever, I could turn a blind eye to it. If that happened in Korea, per se, let's say, just in case, like there's been in the past, and it's definitely getting better, mm-hmm. There's been the a pretty high amount of suicides within the entertainment industry. And a lot of that pressure comes, I would say, not only from social media, but also just from the industry. So like, for example, one of the most demand women in the industry at the times. So she had a friend who was a reporter, I believe. Mm-hmm. And he, at the time, his name was On.
Wait, this is like recent?
This was a while ago. This was in 2008. So this problem has been around for a while. And it has only, if not stayed the same, and probably wavered up and down in terms of how much pressure there is in the Korean culture and in Korea in general. But so Choi, who was a very influential entertainer, mm-hmm. along with On, they both killed themselves because of entertainment. Like they took their lives. Also, somebody a couple years later, what does it say here? People that were directly connected to her ended up doing the same thing because they felt a lot of pressure from the culture, the media, and everything, just because she was associated with that feeling. So it's kind of like this, like, let me set, like, in Korean, and I would say even in me being Japanese, in those cultures, you know, they're very polite cultures, they're very, you know, like, well put together in terms of, like, the society, they do the right things. A lot of the norms are a lot different than what we have in America. Okay. So the negative look, and if you're going to, like, put somebody to shame, somebody to talk about somebody badly, oh, this person got divorced for cheating or whatever it may be, I would feel like the pressure because of those cultures is a lot heavier in Korea for that reason. Mm-hmm. You think about a lot of, you know, a lot of these things in Korea, people like entertainments, they like tabloids, they like reading about, you know, almost these drama things because it's so far from their culture and what they believe in that it's almost to them, it's like, oh, this is like a story, but it's real and there are real people involved. Yeah. And the problem with people in the entertainment business, not only music, is, yo, when people are young, they're scouted out when they're younger. Mm-hmm. So let's say you want to be part of a K-pop group, you might be scouted out when you're, say, like, you know, like 11 or 12, and they'll put you in kind of these tryouts for, it could be years. And mm-hmm. you've got execs who are getting money from this, but you're still on a trial period for, could be 10 years, could be 1 year, it depends. You're not getting paid yeah. for it, but you're getting thrown in these situations where, yeah, you're getting put under the spotlight like this. You're not getting any money. You're getting underpaid. You're being exploited to a level where it's like, yeah, you're being forced to perform. People are writing articles about you, whether they're true or not. And just that pressure, even like living or going on tour, imagine living in like a dorm room or on a tour for that many years and not really being able to have much of a independent say and how things are done, and a lot of pressure just culturally when people get, let's say, shamed online or online bullied or something like that, like one little comment, like the whole Doja thing. I feel like if it was a popular entertainer in Korea 10 years ago, would have easily taken their life, and everybody that person would have known would have done the same because they would have been looked at and scrutinized for, why are you even affiliated with them? Why do you live like this? Why right. do you know this person? Are you like that too? Oh, let's blast them. Let's put them on the spotlight. So it's interesting, like, it's not just in America, but I feel like a lot of other places, especially in Korea, and since Korean music and K-pop is pretty big now, and it's, you know, the culture of it, they're definitely embracing it, has been a pretty big problem. And in terms of social media and the industry in general, and just it has been highly influential in how mental health, you know, is such an important factor, you know, and portraying it right through social media as opposed to doing it the wrong way, where people feel like they're depressed or they have to take their own lives. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, it's a very sad situation.
So one thing that I can speak to that point is, you know, I've dealt with several international artists who are, you know, independent, you know, or major labels. And one thing that I can speak to your point is when you're at that level, people don't realize you're essentially, like, in that genre of K-pop, you're a puppet. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. None of the songs are original. You get, you know, emails of all reference tracks. You know what I'm saying? And then when you're in the creative process, you know, whoever made the reference is pretty fucking good. So you have to make it sound almost exactly like the reference or even better, which is kind of hard. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a few people who can do that, like Chris Brown, Beyonce, like all these people who are, you know, trained performers. Also, everything from your wardrobe down to your choreography, down to your schedule, is your itinerary, your day-to-day is pretty much handled by a manager, right? And like you said, a lot of these guys are pretty much put into like feeder groups, right?
Right.
So boy bands are huge, and there may be like 10 guys in a boy band, but it's pretty much like a head-to-head competition to see who's going to step up and who's going to be like the breakout star. So basically, when your whole life is kind of, when you have no decision in what to wear, what songs you record, what songs get selected, you know, everything from your choreography to the wardrobe is planned out for you, and the perception to the world is that you live this glamorous life, right?
Right.
But inside, you are completely rotten because you have absolutely no control. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I think that is in itself is very depressing, because you see these guys on TV under the lights with, like, you know, the Off-Whites and the Balenciagas and everything looking fly as hell, but then inside they didn't pick that, they didn't design that. The song they right. wrote about the girl isn't even their own original music, or they don't have any room to interpret it because the vocal producer in the studio is like, you know, sing it this way, sing it that way. So you have absolutely no creative control. And when people have no control, we know what they do. They either lash out, you know what I'm saying? Like, either, you know, lash out towards other people or inwards on themselves. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So just speaking from that point, like, I've worked with a lot of international artists, and it's kind of annoying. Like, it's just like their whole process is just, it's complete, it's literally backwards. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you're in the studio, like, it's completely backwards sometimes. So I completely understand why they felt that way over years and years, and the mounting pressure, you know, that people are dealing with. You know what I'm saying?
It's normal to have, you know, issues within yourself, whether it's depression, whether it's drug problems or anything like that, but it's really about what you do with that and how you voice that. And it's great to see artists that actually do that. And that's what makes them so great. Like, you think of Kid Cudi, you think about these people who just, you know, they have this influence because they're themselves, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they've been through that trial and error. They've been through that pain. And, you know, unfortunately some people don't make it all the way through, but they can still, you know, tell their story. But it might be a sadder story for sure, the way it ends, obviously. Mm-hmm. Or just a sadder story in general, if that's kind of your intention.
What I'm saying, as long as you're not threatening anybody or hurting anybody, I think that, you know, your opinion should be heard. And that's what comments are for. So, you know, if I say something, or whoever, Joe, whatever, says something that is wrong, then go in the comments like, yo, bro, like, you were completely wrong. Here's a link to prove you otherwise. You know what I'm saying? So I think discussion, as long as it's cordial and, you know, intelligent, is healthy. You know what I'm saying? There should be both sides. Everybody should be able to speak their piece. And, you know, if you don't agree, then that's okay. I think having arguments with people who don't agree with you are healthy.
Oh, I think absolutely, bro. Because otherwise you're just really getting one side of the story all the time. And definitely probably a biased view on the situation, especially if it's, you know, like you have it with all the news and everything or social media, it's always going to be one-sided. Right. If you have, I mean, that's a great thing. That's one good thing I think that is good about social media on that aspect is if you have those situations, then it's easier for somebody to send a tweet back or say, you know, comment on something and say that. But I mean, just like you said, what we were talking about earlier with YouTube, man, I mean, I feel like if they're limiting and, you know, kind of filtering what can be said and what can't be said, and they just don't even, you know, like stream or play the content, or they're just like, this is restricted from any type of feedback or playing it, then, you know, that's definitely a problem in itself. I think with YouTube, it's an issue because I know since they've been down or since COVID's been happening, they've had a lot less people working in the YouTube studio. So a lot of it is automated machines that are just picking up. They, you know, the people have put in keywords to like, oh, anything negative associated with certain topics will just be automatically flagged. And you'll just be like, they won't even let you upload your video. And you probably, if you do it enough times, suspend your channel or if not delete it.
Yeah. There's a lot of bots out there.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. But the guy, so on Monday, right, in Minneapolis, this guy, George Floyd, went to a grocery store, right? And he tried to buy some groceries with some counterfeit bills, okay? So, boom. He does it. They call the cops on him, right? Nonviolent. He's outside. They cuff him. He's sitting down. He's not resisting. So what ends up happening is there's this officer. I forget his name. I don't even want to mention his name, even if I had it memorized. He's on this guy's neck, and it's on video for 7 minutes, right?
Okay. And
the guy, George, is saying, I can't breathe. Like, please get off me. You know what I'm saying? Mind you, George isn't resisting. You know, he's handcuffed on the floor behind the squad car. He ends up, he died. He passed out, and that was it. Right? Okay. So that happened Monday. Yesterday, Minneapolis people were in the streets rioting, right? Like, people were breaking cop cars. Everybody, you see people with gallons of milk, like, just putting it over their faces to trying to stop the burn from the tear gas and the pepper spray. That is absolute madness, you know what I'm saying? And I said all that because I think it's a lot of pent-up anger and aggression and just overall confusion from what the media's been fueling us and things like that, and just a lot of the history of police brutality and African Americans and Blacks in this country, a lot of it, and it's just being fueled by misinformation and people have cabin fever. So it's a lot of moving parts working together that just kind of exploded, and it's happening all around the country. Like, you see it in Atlanta, you see it in LA, you see it in Minneapolis, you know what I'm saying? So the kicker is that you see places in my home state, Michigan, where they march to the Capitol with AR-15s, rifles, and they're screaming in the cop's face, and they do nothing. They just allow it to happen, right? So there's a huge disparity going on, and I think a lot of it is being perpetuated by ignorance, and just by a lot of old problems that we've been going on for hundreds of years, and a lot of new problems that's been going on since the past 4 months. You know, kind of exacerbate what people are feeling, you know.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what it is. Like you said, it just kind of captured, you have this whole built up angst, this whole built up, you know, emotion behind all of these social problems that have been happening, I feel like, yeah, for years, and definitely being in quarantine for the last couple months. I mean, it doesn't help if a situation like that comes out.
So they got this guy's badge number, they got his name and everything. So of course they went on a deep dive on the internet, and he clearly has a white supremacist agenda. You know what I'm saying?
Like, so what have they said now about the police officer?
Oh, four of them got fired.
Okay. Yeah.
But the thing is that's not enough. Like okay, like that's the minimum that should have happened. Like that's that, you know what I mean? Like that's the base, you know?
Right.
I feel like we need to move beyond that to try and get justice for what's going on. And we can't make it, you know, make it good for Eric Gardner and like everybody who's been a victim of police brutality that wasn't justified. But I think that them being fired isn't close to being enough.
You know, right.
We need to systematically make the change and you know, the people who are at the top, in my opinion, are sometimes the most evil, the police chiefs, the sergeants, things like that. Those are the guys who are perpetuating this type of culture, you know, in law enforcement, where, let's say, if you do, and I'm not saying that all police officers are bad, but what I'm saying is that if you put a good officer in a situation with a bad officer, he's also then has that social obligation to back up his partner. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So even good people put in a bad system, which then make them bad people. You know what I'm saying? So I think there needs to be a systematic change, which isn't going to happen overnight or over a week. It's going to take a decade and just a long, basically like a coup of change, where just there just needs to be people who have values and just don't have racist agendas, you know. But that's a long battle, and that's a longer conversation, and legislation needs to be had in order for that to change, you know.
So what kind of legislative changes to the administrations and to the law enforcement would you change, and or would it be more of like a mental and a value change?
Well, some get it right. So some, like, if you're like a state trooper, you get cultural training. You get like 6 months of like certain situational awareness and things like that. You know what I'm saying? And so I think that needs to be done across the board. You know what I'm saying? You need to understand how certain people are going to react, how people react in groups. You know what I'm saying? And just kind of being aware of what's going on. And what's been coming out in the past few weeks is that a lot of these officers are repeat offenders. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
This isn't the first time that they, you know, have had a complaint brought to them or have acted, you know, in an over-aggressively way. So we kind of know who these guys are, right?
Right.
And the shield of silence is a real thing. So they'll shell out the $15,000, $20,000, $25,000, $30,000, you know, for the court case or for the legal fees, whatever the case may be, and the guy still has the job. Well, I think that there needs to be a lot more severe repercussions for these guys, because they're supposed to be protecting the population. And I guarantee, if you go ask a black man, you know, I should pull it up. I was watching TV the other day, and there was a doctor, you know, a physician, and he's like, I work in the COVID crisis, I do this, I do that. And he was saying, the scariest part of my day is when I'm right here. And he was sitting in the driver's seat of his car. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And he's a black dude, you know what I'm saying? And he was a brother, and he was talking about, he was like, you know, sometimes I get pulled over and try and pull my physician badge up so they can see it. Maybe that I can use that type of privilege as like a security blanket, you know what I'm saying? And just how we've all been forced to, you know, think a certain way when cops come. So I think it needs to, I know that things need to change on both sides. You know what I'm saying?
Because right.
They're saying that we react a certain way because, you know, I might get shot. I'm putting my life on the line, right? Well, that's definitely a fact, but we also need to take consideration about how other people feel. So I think just as a society, it's not going to change anytime soon, but I think a conversation needs to be had that will start to make the change. You know what I'm saying? So,
right.
And also kind of segueing into that, which I don't think helps, is what we were talking about the other day, was just how social media affects all this, right? Because I know for me, it's not good for my mental health to constantly view images like yesterday when the whole thing happened with George. Every other image on my timeline was this officer's neck, was this officer's knee on his neck. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And then a few hours later, it's like me watching a developing story of what's going on around the country with the riots and things like that. And it's not healthy, you know what I'm saying, to constantly see that brutality. Because one, when I see somebody fight the cops, what does that do? I then become desensitized, right? Because I'm not scared anymore. I'm like, yo, I just seen homie right here do it. All right, so I'm gonna do the same thing.
Right.
But my situation is completely different. You know what I'm saying? So the repercussions could, you know, who knows what could happen, right? And then the inverse is that, you know, cops have Facebook, they have Instagram, Twitter. So they see these things going on too. And they're like, okay, he looks like that. So when I go out on patrol, I see another guy that looks like that. So I'm going to react how he acted, because I got to protect my life. I got a wife and kids at home that I got to worry about. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like social media, I don't think, because people think that they're creating awareness by reposting certain videos. And I think in some respects, you're actually doing more harm than you are good. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely. I think it is, just like you said, because there's both sides to it. It's like, yeah, if you see that video and you're going to be like, you're going to go out and you're going to be like, oh shit, you know what I mean? Like, I'm going to fucking take down a cop, or I could do that shit too if I get in that situation. Like, it already gives you this negative connotation with law enforcement, or albeit somebody else in general that's not law enforcement. And then likewise too, it's like, yo, you've got the people on that side who are, I got to protect my family. I got a family. Look, if I see this and they're reposting this and this, yo, they're going to garner a lot much more hate towards me. So of course I'm going to have to try to be a little bit more aware. But when the situation comes down to it, they might get spooked as well and just be like, okay, this is how I react. This is what I remember from my training. If I'm put in a, you know, a critical situation, which it may not, or may right. even be the case, you know? And I think it's absolutely crazy how social media has done that, not only in America, because it is detrimental, man. I feel like it's definitely something that can be good, but I feel like, especially when we're talking about how it influences hip hop culture in general, it's really a double-edged sword, man. Like, I feel like it goes both ways, because I feel like a lot of hip hop, I feel like there's a difference between hip hop and there's rap. Like, I feel like rap culture, I almost put social media into the category of rap, where it kind of gives all of hip hop a negative connotation just for those reasons. Whether it's, you know, something like you were saying something about, was it Doja Cat?
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Her whole thing, situation with the song, and you can enlighten me on that. But I feel like it's definitely, I feel like, you know, social media is definitely, I think, yeah, just down, not really downplayed, but as it's just made a lot harder to see really what the true essence, I feel like, of what the culture of hip hop is and what we are trying to like explain to people and say like, yo, this is social injustice. There's a right way to telling my story. This is just how I get heard. And I think that's just being interpreted the wrong way because of the use of a lot of social media, especially nowadays when you do have, you know, things that are very biased sides, or you have people behind a movement, or somebody's sparking up a conversation because one artist said one thing about something, and every, you know, and then comes down to it. And then just because that artist is popular, they have to apologize just because they're in the public spotlight and they're looked up to. And a lot of people are influenced by that person, where really, when it came down to it, it was just their opinion. Like, but people take that the wrong way because of this, I feel like.
That's what it was, right? I mean, with the Doja Cat, you know, I really, it's something that's important because it deals with race relations. She was caught in an alt-right chat room with like a bunch of, you know, a bunch of white guys slinging around racial slurs and things like that. And then she also, so that happened. And then, you know, so the internet, of course, goes crazy, bro. Like, you can find out so much. When people motivate on the internet and they want to take somebody down, they do it. So they found a song that kind of referenced like an alt-right racial phrase, didn't do nothing. You know what I'm saying? And she made a song out of that.
Mm.
In her defense, she took something that was hurtful to her and kind of flipped it and made a parody of it, right? But what I think is the bigger problem is just the fact that the whole cancel culture thing that we have going on, you know, within the Black Twitter, the Black social media, where if you see somebody do something like that, you instantly, like, you're canceled, you're done. You know what I'm saying? Because Doja, she didn't get any, I've known of her music for a while now, but she has a number one song with her and Nicki Minaj, Say So, right? Like, it's going, so she's on the radio out here in the grocery store, so of course she's getting a lot more exposure. So people want to cancel her now. And I think that is very toxic. And I think what we need to do, instead of, you know, automatically canceling people, depending, you know, like, certain people need to be canceled, right? Depending on what their actions are. But with Doja, I think maybe why don't we, you know, unpack her situation, have a conversation about it, and let's kind of figure out where the problem is. Because if you just cancel somebody, you don't solve anything. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely not.
All you do is just, oh, they're done. I don't fuck with them anymore. But the inherent problem still exists. You know what I'm saying? So that's why, whether it's dealing with, you know, race relations, whether it's like within your personal relationships, you know what I'm saying? Like whatever your personal preference is, or if we're dealing with bigger social issues, you know, I think we need to have a constructive dialogue with leaders and people of both sides who can have an intelligent, articulate conversation and have people from the community kind of, what's the word I'm looking for, contribute to those discussions. So that way we can build and move forward, right? Because the way I look at, like, when Trump got elected, right, when we were both working in Midtown, is that we would see thousands of people protesting. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like what's your protest going to do? It's not going to do absolutely, it's going to do absolutely nothing. But what it's doing for you, the individual, is allowing for you to kind of have like this group therapy session. You know what I'm saying? That's exactly, because you see people like, they're not going to protest and they got to go to work because you got to go and you got to make some money, right? So they would come on Saturday and Sunday. So I think that's kind of what we need to do. We need to, you know, get together in groups, talk about these situations, kind of put things in place where we can move forward as an entire, you know, country, not just a small, you know, subculture of the country, and make some educated moves and actually talk to people about it and make some changes and do some stuff instead of just reposting stuff online, because that only makes the problem worse, you know?
Absolutely, man.
You know? And I would like for us to maybe kind of figure out some type of way to have that forum where, even if it's just starting out with people that we know and people that they know, you know, friends of friends, where we could have that open forum where we could just kind of just start putting those positive vibes out there and putting that energy out there, because I want to practice what I preach. You know what I'm saying? I just don't want to get up here and scream about it and then not do anything the next day, you know? So,
right. So, I think especially if you say something that's, you know, maybe not, you know, acceptable, you know, within even a personal level or a societal level, but I feel like, yeah, I think it definitely needs to be something where you can get together and almost progressively come up with a better solution. Because I feel like sometimes just apologizing for something, almost like the whole situation with Doja Cat, it's not only to save face, but it's definitely, like you said, there's nothing is being solved. That's it. Like, you're ending the discussion on that end. And people, whether they're fans or not, be like, oh, that's okay, I'm going to accept that. So maybe I won't play part of the cancel culture, or maybe I'll still listen to her stuff. But in the end of the day, it doesn't really resolve any of the issues that came up, because obviously it just seems like every year or every month, almost every day, there seems like to be another situation that is somewhat similar, if not the exact same type of situation. And then everybody's just flipping out about it again. And then you hear about it, and it's like, it's the new news for on Twitter for like a day. And then you're like, okay, like, what the fuck is next? And that's a bad mentality for me to be in, is like, where you're thinking, or especially as a culture, being like, oh shit, okay, what's next? Like, I don't want to have to think like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah.
When it comes to Doja specifically, she released like an I'm sorry post. And right. It was BS, because for one, like, if you follow her, like, I've followed her music for a few years now, or just her social media, that's not how she talks. So it was clearly something fabricated by like
her team or something.
Team, and they put it out. They disable the comments. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like, even when you do apologize, it's not heartfelt, and you don't mean it, and you just put.
That's ingenuine. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd make a fucking song about that, you know? I'd make a song about fucking, you know, if I was a popular artist, I'd make a song about being fucking disingenuous and like, yo, you want to be real and fucking, you know, like, be real about it and just apologize for yourself if you feel sorry for it.
Right.
If you don't, just own up to your shit. Like, some people, I just like that. It's like, yo, just own up to how you feel. And, well, that's a different time. I mean, it's like coming down to what we're talking about, is freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. Like, there's a right and a wrong to doing that. Yeah, obviously, if you've gone wrong and you've done about it in those ways. But, I don't know. I really don't know much about that situation. If you're...
No, yeah, I'm with you, man. I'm gonna change the topic, man, because it's kind of gotten me depressed. Not depressed, but fired up. But one thing that I'm super excited about, in like an hour, Tesla is going to be launching two astronauts into space.
Maybe they'll fucking rename the space shuttle, the little baby space shuttle, AEX-21-25-39, you know? Fucking, yeah. Fucking, this shit is crazy, but yeah, those look fucking, those are heard futuristic looking suits.
They have been informed. Launch director Mike Kaler has called a scrub for the day. Yeah, and we got the feedback when the Dragon team informed Bob and Doug. They said, we gave it a good try, but they understand. And we are here to try another day.
Oh, okay.
So right now we did officially hold the clock.
We are here to hold the clock, and we will be launching tomorrow at his time.
See, they found her LinkedIn.
Right.
I mean, they found where she adopted the dog. You know what I mean? They got the dog taken away. They got her job taken away. So her life within, not even within 4 hours, was completely ruined. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I'm lucky. Like, I'm like, you know what? They want to make examples of us. Well, we got to do the exact same thing.
Right.
Because way too many black men have been falsely accused, have been murdered, on death row for crime they didn't commit, I can't think of, like, you know, I look like how I look. I'm a big bearded black man, and people automatically, get a little tense when I walk around, but I don't have that intention. You know what I'm saying? So I think sometimes you got to make examples of people and let them know, like, hey, there's two sides of this coin, and, your life can be ruined as well. You're just trying to ruin somebody else's.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
Bitch, man, you kind of get what you deserve. Some people, if you look at the comments, some people feel sorry for her. I don't feel sorry at all.
I don't feel sorry. No, bro, he never did anything wrong in the first place. Like, bro, that's how it's going to feel. Like, you know what I mean?
Right. But, also one big critique that I have of that particular situation, which I, myself, I kind of wonder, like, oh, is it that big of a deal? Like, should you really, like, put that much energy into it? Is I feel like nothing would have gotten done. I don't think she would have lost her job if she didn't strangle the dog in the video. You know what I'm saying? I think that obviously, what she did with the dog was wrong, right? But I think if the dog was out of the equation, right, and he caught her doing something else that she wasn't supposed to be doing without the animal, I think she would still be employed. And I think, in my opinion, I think that's fucked up. You know what I'm saying? Because, the animal, not only did you have, the activists for, social justice involved, once the dog got involved, you have the animal rights people who went absolutely ballistic. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So to me, I'm like, all right, like, don't complain about what happened. You got the results that you wanted. But to me, it's like the way that it happened, I don't think it happened how I would want to see it. You know what I'm saying? Because I think a big part of her losing her job and it being such a big deal was because she choked the dog. You know what I'm saying?
I think it maybe, I would think the dog definitely plays the important role. I don't know if it was that situation. I think it's just the fact that by law, you're not supposed to have dogs in that area of the park without a leash. So I think him on video, whichever reason he was taking video for, and then being like, okay, your dog needs to be on a leash. This area in the Ramble, like, you're supposed to have him on a leash. This is, and he was bird watching or whatever he was doing. So I think that was the thing. Like, if there wasn't a dog to put in that situation, even if he was filming it, like, who is he to say, what grounds would he say that, where you could easily be like, oh, well, what did he do before he put on the camera? Like, this is just obviously like, yo, all you're doing is asking to take your dog off the leash. And this lady is flipping her story.
Right.
And I think it's that mixed with, like the whole thing with the animal rights, like, yo, that's fucked up. Like,
because while she was on the phone, right, you saw her like choking the dog. And that's why people, turned up. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
No, and her voice changed and everything, bro. And I'm just like, I was just like, okay, well, whatever. I mean, she definitely deserved every bit. I would not feel sorry for her at any level, Yeah. And then she apologized after battle later. And she's like, yo, I'm sorry. The man didn't deserve it. I'm like, bro, like, it's too late. Like, your shit's taken away. That's fine. But you basically, like, what the fuck were you thinking?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
Like, I think it's good. I think people need to be exploited like that, because I feel like that happens way more on a regular basis, especially if you're somebody, that's black, Asian, Hispanic, like anybody like that, that's,
So let me ask you this. So, within the day and age, right, technology is taking over our lives, whether you like it or not, right? Mm-hmm. So, what's the policy, or not even, what's the proper action that one take, whether you're whatever you are, right? If someone is filming you against your will, right? Let's say, you know, I'm doing something completely legal, but somebody for whatever reason feels that, you know, they need to document my activity. Okay. Now I feel like I do have a certain amount of privacy that should be protected. What steps do I need to take to have that individual stop filming me? You know what I'm saying? Like what's the proper way to handle that? You know, is my question. Because I see it happening again, both ways. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, because I feel like, you know, if you are in a public space, you know, you should be able to film. Like, let's say we're in Central Park and you're bird watching. You know, if Lucy over here happens to get in your video, then so be it. But if you were filming, you know, this particular woman exclusively and she doesn't want it, you know, is there a proper way to not to engage with the person who's filming and ask them to stop? Like, I want to know what's the proper way to handle that. You know what I'm saying?
That's a good question, because that's the first thing that popped in my head when I heard about the video. Was why was he recording in the first place? Just this woman, like the ramble. There's not a lot of people around. You know what I mean? So I guess I don't know. For me, I feel like if it was my situation, there would be two ways I would handle it. It would either be A, I'm gonna just be aggressive and I'm gonna film you back and then ask you on camera when I'm recording as well. Like, yeah. Oh, is there a reason why you're recording me? Like, what's going on here? Or I would just simply walk away.
Right.
But I think that's hard too, because if it's somebody, or especially like if I'm a female or somebody's filming me and they think something is suspicious of me that I'm doing, which they doesn't go with their beliefs or whatever, they think it's unlawful, then yeah, I would probably get confrontational. But knowing that they are filming, I would either film back so I would know whatever I'm doing. I am also filming myself, so I need, that would make me automatically aware that I need to be careful of what I'm doing just because I know that I'm filming myself now too.
Right.
Or I would just walk away because I feel like if I didn't pull out my phone and I stayed there, it probably could get into another situation.
Mm-hmm.
And who knows to say they're not doing a live stream. Like, even if you took the phone and threw it on the ground, like
It's already in the world, right?
Yeah. You never know. So that's what I would do. That's a good question. What would you do?
One thing that I was thinking, right? You know, I thought about, you know, I could, you know, whip up my phone and kind of give my POV as well. Mm-hmm. But I also wanted it to be known. I want to say, while you are filming, you know, but this is like, you know, I do not consent to you filming me. I do not give
exactly,
you know, and I want that to be on their film and then I'll be on their camera, be on their phone. And I would do the same thing. So I have my proof. You know what I'm saying?
Because that's true. Because as soon as you say that, bro, that's like, and then if you show that video to somebody, you know, then it's like, yo, they've said that, so anything thereafter could be done. And that's the problem I feel like with videos too now, is like, yo, you could just edit this, the front part out, and then put it out on social media. Yeah. So they don't even know that you said that unless you would record it.
Right. So I would definitely want to put that in. Like, look, I'm acknowledging, like, this is today's date. You know what I'm saying? You know, what is it? May 27th. You know what I'm saying? At 4:12. Boom. I do not consent to you filming me right now. Please stop. You know what I'm saying? And then I have my evidence. And then, like you said, I will go on about my way, because who knows where that situation could escalate. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because I can see myself. I mean, we were at the park Wednesday. You know what I'm saying? And there was, you know, there were a group of people on roller skates, because, you know, they took all the rims off the court. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, there's a group of people minding their own business, maybe like 7 to 11 people, you know what I'm saying? And they were on roller skates, you know? And then, so we saw them. And then at the other end of the park, we're walking and we hear, you know, this one guy complain to one of the groundskeepers. They're like, hey, those folks over there in the basketball court with the skates, they're not social distancing. They're not wearing masks, whatever the case may be. I'm like, bro, like, that has absolutely nothing to do with you. Like, why would you even bring that up? You know what I'm saying? Like, why?
Yeah, do you need to go over there? And if they're not social distancing, why would you go over there?
Yeah, it's like,
why do you care?
It's like literally like a half mile away from, like a quarter mile and a half mile away from where you are. Like,
right.
Like, what's it to you? You know
what I'm saying?
No matter, you could just be out enjoying time with your family and things escalate. very quickly, even if you're just minding your own business.
Absolutely, bro.
What I'm saying. So,
especially nowadays, man, because same thing. I went to the park. I was going to run, and I ran in the kind of in the middle of the day in Astoria Park. I live right next to it, as you know, bro. And they just redid the fucking track and field again and wasted the fucking neighborhood's tax money. And they just re-fucking did it 2 years ago. And now they just redid it again. They tore everything up and then made it new. But anyway, I was going to run over there. Dude, it was so tracked on the – on. It was so packed on the field and the track just where – you know, the where it's going to go run.
Yeah.
Well, there's at least there was three different games of soccer going on.
Mm-hmm.
There was one football game, and then there was like mobs of people running around, and you could hear some people yelling at each other like, "Oh my God, get out of the way. Like, you're social distancing." I'm like, "Bro, if you go to the park, you see this fucking many people in an area. Why the fuck do you go there?" Like,
right.
If you see one soccer game, why are you going to start another soccer game? And then you see people running and you want to run, go run somewhere else. Like you're walking into your own problem.
Mm-hmm.
And then you already have all this built up cabin fever or whatever. And you want to take out on everybody because you've been watching fucking Lilo and Stitch for fucking rerun after rerun and fucking just watching that movie over and over. And you're pissed because of it. Then that's not our fault. But
right.
I don't get people sometimes, man. And I think it's crazy. Like if it's not yours, I feel like, yeah, if it's a threatening situation, then of course I would get involved, but it would, you know, I would not put myself in a situation where it's like, oh, these guys over here are doing this, you know, like.
Yeah. I'm against that, man. And like, yeah, it's a growing problem that we as a society are going to have to evolve and figure out how we're going to manage it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, these are unprecedented times and a lot of people, myself included, don't really know what to do. You know what I'm saying? You know, we're all figuring it out together. But a lot of people, you know, think it's me against you. You know what I'm saying? When in reality, we're all in this together. You know what I'm saying? Come out on top, you know? You got some hand sanitizer around, bro? What's good? I feel like I'm going to... That cough was crazy. No, I'm kidding. I'm fucking with you.
It is crazy. Oh, you fucking... Pull out the lavender. You got me looking around. Fucked up because I farted at the same time, so it don't smell good, but it should. You know what I mean? I was like, God damn, what the fuck? You know, scared the shit out of me, literally. You order one sandwich. Bodega Bites. How much is that? Bodega. Bodega Bites. Bodega Bites.